Esmeralda Abd'Allah-Álvarez Ramírez is a social and political activist engaging with all forms of discrimination, but in particular, racism and sexism. Born in Cuba, she is the daughter of the Cuban musician Lucy Collantes and of Jesus Guerra, a Cuban composer and musician. Her family moved to Hamburg in Germany in the 50s. Since, Esmeralda has lived and worked in Germany, the UK and Cuba, always active in Black queer feminist spaces. A few months ago, I was looking for an expert on Cuban history for a project that I am working on. Esmeralda saw my open call and reached out by saying that she was interested in the work I had done on Faze Jansen together with Princella Bijar, and that her parents had also been musicians in Germany around the same time. In my practice as a culture producer, curator and writer, I am invested in how people around me, especially in the Caribbean and so-called Latin America, keep their family archives intact. What are the stories that they hold? And what do they tell us about the present? In our conversation, we briefly speak about Faze Jansen. Esmeralda speaks on her father's legacy and how she is keeping it alive. Lastly, she generously shared what it has been like for her to move back to the place she calls home, Havana in Cuba.
Cadencia de tu voz divina, la rima de amor. Y en tus ojeras se ven las palmeras, borrachas de sol, borrachitas de sol.
Faze Jansen and my parents were active musicians. Of the same generation,
yes,
in Germany, and it's very fascinating for me to find Black people of those times, and whatever I can find written or recorded on them. So I was a child when we first came to Germany, and there was still a lot of live music being played. And we traveled a lot, the whole family, because that was the nature of being a musician. So we moved a lot. And it was an insecure life because contracts were mostly only, well, at the beginning for 1 year, but then they became shorter. It means less time, 6 months, 3 months contracts, then a weekend, then a day, then maybe a couple of hours. And so on. So, you know, by the time I was a teenager, my parents already had to find other jobs. They couldn't live off of the music anymore because there was no live music being played. The discotheques came in. And also my parents played Latin American music. Cha-cha-cha, and everything that was Latin American and some jazz maybe. But it was a very difficult time for them also. Having a family, you know, me and my brother and my mother. So it wasn't that easy for them. And I really admired them for, you know, changing their lifestyle after they, you know, they didn't have no more opportunities in the music business.
So your father was a musician and your mother as well?
My mother was a singer in my father's band.
Okay.
Yeah, my father was a band leader. He was a composer and He traveled out of Cuba in 1955 or 54 with contract, which means that he traveled out legally. He was not persecuted or anything. He was not political. And that's why we always had our Cuban nationality intact. We always looked to have a Cuban passport.
So that was important for you.
Yes.
For your parents, yeah, to maintain the Cuban passport.
The Cuban nationality, exactly. Yeah. It wasn't so easy at the time to become German.
Right.
When I was 16, or before I turned 16, the Foreign Office of Germany asked me if I wanted to have a German passport, but then I would have to give up my Cuban passport. And I didn't want that because I still had my grandmother and my aunts and cousins in Cuba, and I wanted to be able to visit them. I didn't actually know many stories of Black musicians from the 50s or 60s that lived in Germany. There were not so many Black people at the time in Germany.
So what was it like? Would your parents tour, you know, like would your parents tour throughout Europe or in Germany and you would be there? And what would the kind of establishments be where they were working, and who were the people who came there? Was there like also other Black musicians that you would meet sometimes there, or was it really very kind of like a very isolating place, you know, as like a Black family, as a Black Cuban family in Germany in the 60s?
Yes, it was isolating because, you know, we didn't have Black friends as children, my brother and myself. I didn't really meet a lot of Black children. And my parents, they were under contract, usually by establishments that were very rooted in Germany. You know, there were Tanzlokal, so and so. You know, they give them this contract usually for, as I said, a number of months or weeks. It always depended, but in the early days, they were longer contracts, so we always moved to that city for a while. But we kept a base in Hamburg. Yeah. We had a room there.
Had you heard about Fazia Jansen before?
Like, no.
In your childhood? Because she was also born and raised in Hamburg, right? And Hans Masakoi as well.
So yes.
Was there like any overlap or?
Never.
Never.
I only heard through ESD,
okay,
about their existence. I didn't even know them. You know, I knew only the musicians that were close to my father in Hamburg. Like, for example, there was Dennis Busby. He was a pianist, and he was very well known.
Thank you.
we lived in the city near Gänsemarkt in Hamburg. There's Schauspielhaus and Staatsoper very close. So sometimes on the street, I would meet Black people that were coming out of the wardrobe where the artists stay. And you could know that they must be opera singers or some kind of musicians. But we as children, we were always happy, and they were happy to meet us, you know, on the streets, but we never had a close contact with them. But my father was well known, and my family was well known among the resident Black musicians of the time.
Like a lot, and I noticed that most of the things that I could find, they were written by you.
Yes.
And I found that so fascinating. And also last night I saw on the blog Negra Tenía Que Ser. Saw that you and Sandra, you both wrote also like a piece on the blog. And so I'm just so curious to know, how do you keep this legacy of your, yeah, of your family and like of your father's history alive? They're not like so well spread, like on YouTube, for example. Like, have you thought about also, you know, like republishing some of the records? Kind of what has been this whole, yeah, what has been your whole approach to kind of conserving?
Well, this is the legacy inheritance I have, which I'm still due to realize, because it's not easy. My father's work was not published as such. Back in Cuba in the 40s, when he was having hits in Cuba, they were performed by other artists, other singers, and they were recorded by other singers. For example, Daniel Santos did a lot of my father's works. So he himself didn't get a lot of opportunities at the radio stations, where at the time the up-and-coming musicians and singers used to have spots. Well, it must have been really difficult for him to get access to these spots. And but he still managed to have a couple of hits that, you know, some of them are still being played today. But many people don't know that he's the composer, Jesús Guerra, and they would even have this saying, Amique. It's one of his main songs, and it became like a saying that everybody uses in everyday life, but, you know, it was his invention. Amique. A song, and it's dedicated to a woman, Juanita, whatever. and so many people have recorded this song, even Irakere, that are very, very famous, recorded it back in the 70s in one of their albums. And now recently, another group Seteto Santiaguero. They have made an album called Amique with that very song as the lead title of their album, and it received a Grammy Award. Yes, so for me, it's important that this legacy and my father's work is recognized. And this is why I am going to hopefully reach out to the authorities. Although the authorities in Cuba have been telling my mother that's still alive and receiving royalties for my father's work, the Cuban authorities are not really paying any of that because these works have been written before the Cuban Revolution. So they claim that there are no records.
Right.
And also there are recordings from my aunt. My aunt was a singer and her name was Sara Collantes. And my father brought my aunt and my uncle, Hector Collantes, to Germany. And they recorded with Polydor at the time. That was a label in Germany. I don't think it exists anymore. And yes, there are some, yeah, there are some proofs still to be found that had to do with my family, because my aunt was a bit younger, of course, and she was an attractive singer. Yeah.
And your mom, did she record?
No, my mother didn't record. She stopped singing before my father stopped making music actively and started to work normal jobs and look after us children.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me a bit about what moved you to move back to Cuba? I was reading your essay, Notes on Repatriation, where you, yeah, first of all, I really appreciated it. I really appreciated it because I felt it was very nuanced. I felt it
Thank
was
you.
Yeah, I felt that it was very nuanced, that it wasn't, you know, it was, I guess, like acknowledging the position that you take and like really situating yourself within Cuban society, like while acknowledging the privileges and also like the consequences of what it means to come back and like how your environment, I guess, like reacts to you as a as this foreign person that is somehow foreign, but also not. Yes, so I was very touched and very moved by that. And I wanted to ask what made you move back to Cuba after so many years, after 60 years, as you write in the essay, to Cuba? And yeah.
Well, many people ask me this question. And recently, I'm still trying to find out about myself, you know. I'm asking myself, why am I choosing to live in this precarious country? And I have found out for myself recently that I needed to catch up on certain emotions, maybe my identity. It has to do with the country itself, because really and truly, I never felt German, never in my life. Although now I have a British and a German passport, apart from the Cuban. So I only have a German passport because of the Brexit. That I have it for 2 years now, but all these years I didn't even want a German passport. It's just
political reasons, basically.
Well, it's more identity and emotional reasons, because
no, the passport, the German passport, is really like for political.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because if it wasn't for the Brexit, I wouldn't have needed it. And so, but I am glad now. I do have it, and I have this privilege, of being able to use these passports, because obviously it opens borders. And I find myself still learning so much about myself. Why am I the way I am? The way I react to things, the way I think about things, my behavior. And it's clear to me now, it's more clear to me now while I am in Cuba that I do have also these roots, these traits of mentality inside of me. Although the environment in Germany influenced me so much and has actually molded me also, but I can relate to what's going on around me in Cuba just as well, or even better, because I feel I belong there, I'm at home there, and they can laugh about my jokes. You know, it's impossible in Germany to find people that understand your humor, because it's just different here,
right?
And the closeness that that you can achieve in interactions with people, with humans and even animals, is different in Cuba. I miss that. I miss that all my life.
Borracha de sol. Borrachitas de sol.
Borrachas de sol.
Borrachas de sol.